here. Welcome. Spring is here. And better than that, you're here. And man, our church family, we rock, don't we? Man, and the reason why we rock is because we have a rocking God. Isn't that awesome? Man, we have a good God, and He loves you. He loves us. And He's ready to show Himself strong this morning. I believe that with all my heart. So if you got your Bibles, I want you to turn to Revelation chapter 3. And I want to just share some things with you, and we're going to continue our series Sold Out. We got just this week and next week, and then in April we're going to be doing something a little different, but a few more weeks than this, and I just want to share some things that just really the Lord spoke to me this past week. I was challenged this past week, and I'm going to bring that challenge to you, and it's not to be, like, I'm going to just tell everybody knows I love you. That's just it. I love you. And so what we do, and one thing that I really love about this church is we're not here we don't have itching ears. Now, what I mean, that doesn't mean if you scratch your, I'm not talking about that, but in 2 Timothy chapter 3, you can actually see in these last days, there are people that actually want to hear messages, but they want to hear them that makes them feel good. Yeah. Now, I'm not saying that this is not going to make you feel good. This is going to feel good because it's freeing. Yeah. But part of it is because we also want to be everything that God has called us to be. Yeah. Remember, our big assignment, what we want to do is, I live intentionally for that one day. Remember, we talked last week about having an eternal mindset, and a lot of people are living in this earth waiting for the moment that they become 65, they can retire and now live the rest of their time here on earth with that. That's fine, that's great, but more higher and more better is to live with an eternal mindset of, okay, I'm living for a day that I'm going to stand before Jesus face to face and give an account for my life. That's the day. That's what I want to put back in our mind constantly, because it's so easy just to kind of carry on and do life, right? It's easy to get caught up. It's already March 19th, people, 2017. It felt like I just said Happy New Year's the other day. I'm asking people when I run out of conversation, so what is your New Year's resolution? Somebody didn't catch that. Anyways, it's March. That's what I'm trying to say. So if there's a lull in the conversation, that's a sentence that you can ask. But we're hungry to do everything God has called us to do, because listen, the time is short. Jesus is coming back, and we need to reach people, we need to establish people, and we need people going. Yeah. Hoorah. And that's why we're talking about sold out. That's what we've been doing this entire month. So Revelation chapter 3 and verse 20, I want you to look at this, and I'm going to give you right now the big picture for why we're talking about sold out, just the big focus of it. It says, I have the Living Bible translation here just for this part, but follow along. It says, Jesus is speaking, right? Your Bible's red? Yeah. Red words mean red, obviously, and it's Jesus. He said, look. Everybody say, look. Look. What does your translation say?
Behold.
Behold. That's just an older word for look, right? I'm just trying to get Shalina just to show her that I do use big words up here. Behold. It's no, look. That's what it means. Look. What is he saying? I have been standing at the door. And I am constantly knocking. If anyone hears me calling him and opens the door, I will come in and fellowship with him and he with me. Now, who is Jesus talking to in the book of Revelation? He's talking to a church, and more specifically, he's talking to a pastor of a church, right? But he's talking to the church as a whole, because as the leadership, so the church, right? But individually, we can look at this. But God desires and he craves a closeness with you on a personal level, right? And I mean, you've heard that so much, but don't let that just become familiar to you. He desires, God Almighty desires a closeness with you, an intimate relationship with you. He wants it. Now, so individually, we can answer that. But also from a church body, God desires and he craves to move in and through his church. So what is Jesus doing right now this morning? He's knocking. What's required? A response. If anyone hears him, what does we do? We open the door and we let him in. And he said, I will come and dine with him. Other translations, message says, well, we'll simply have a meal together. That's what he's wanting to do. And we know this. So the question is, what are you going to do with this knocking? You got to do something with the knock. Because listen, after a while, anybody ever have somebody at their door that just continually knocked? Whether it's your kid when you're in the shower or the bathroom? Papa, Papa, Papa. Yeah, I hear you, son. I'll be right there. But it's Jesus is standing there, and he's going, fam, Marcel, Pastor Marlene, and he just knocks and knocks and knocks. So I want to just basically come to alarm you that the knock is going on, so answer the door. Because the knock isn't going to stop. Why? Because he cares about you too much to stop knocking.
Oh, that's good.
Absolutely, because he's not going to just go, oh, no answer, okay, well, I tried. No, he will be there until you open that door.
Yeah.
And he'll be there even if you don't open the door.
Right.
So the best thing for us to do is
open the door.
Open the door. Everybody say, open the door.
Open the door.
Open the door. That's what we want to do. So individually, you have to ask that question, what do I do with the knocking? And then as a church, we have to ask ourselves the question, what are we going to do with the knocking? Here's the thing. I do not want Jesus knocking on these front doors.
Yeah.
I refuse that. And so what we've made a decision as pastors is we're saying, Jesus, the door is completely open for you to have full access into this church. Not just what we do on a Sunday service, but for everything that we do throughout the weeks, Jesus, you have full reign and complete access to us. Now, you know, that's a good thing. But not only that, it doesn't happen by just default. It doesn't just, like Jesus doesn't just come barge in. Remember, he's a gentleman. So it doesn't matter. There can be thousands of other churches, but you have to on purpose open the door. You don't just go, no, yeah, that's nice, Jesus is here. Well, no, you have to invite him in. You have to do something with that knocking. And that's what we're going to talk a little bit about this, but this is the whole heart behind it is, what are you going to do with that knock? Because 2 Chronicles chapter 16 and verse 9, this is the heart of God. This is his desire. It says, for the eyes of the Lord search back and forth across the whole earth, looking for people whose hearts are fully committed toward him so that he can show his strength. Other translations say great power through them. God desires to move powerfully on your behalf. He wants to. What's required for him to move? A fully committed heart. A sold out heart. A heart that's not divided. Well, I'm interested in this and I'm interested in that. That is completely sold out to what he wants accomplished. Now, I'm saying this, but I'm also preaching to myself. Because I want to get to that place where I'm sold out. I don't have this. Oh, no, yeah, I have three or four different areas of my heart that aren't towards him. I want Jesus. You're knocking on the door. Come on in.
Yeah.
Here I am, right? Okay. So go to Hebrews chapter 8.
Come on.
First-hand relationship. This is what he's interested in. Now, aren't you glad about this? I'm going to just, while you're in Hebrews, let me just read something to you in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. It says, there is only one God and one mediator who can reconcile God and humanity, the man Christ Jesus. He gave his life to purchase freedom for everyone. This is the message God gave to the world at just the right time. So what is this all saying? Basically, first-hand relationship, God doesn't want you to have sloppy seconds.
Right.
Or messy thirds, or dirty fours. He wants you to have first-hand information.
Right.
There is nobody standing between you and Jesus knocking on the door.
Yeah.
I don't stand between you and Jesus. I don't stand between you and the Father. I'm saying that as a pastor. I don't stand that. That's not my place.
That's right.
What do pastors, what are the fivefold ministry gifts here for? They're here to strengthen and equip the saints for the work of the ministry. We're not here to be God like it was in the Old Testament. Remember, all the people had to go to Moses to find out what is God saying. You don't need me. Why? Because you have a mediator. You have a man knocking on your door continually.
That's so good.
And it's not me. It would be me if you had some apple crisp or something, but I'm just, come on now. But it's Jesus. He's there and he's knocking. That's so good news, right? I don't know. Some other religions have different things. You got to approach the prophet. You got to approach the man of God to hear what God is saying. No. Why? Because we live in the new covenant. God made a covenant with you and I. And what does he want? This covenant between you and him, not between him, me, and you. That's crazy. That's not firsthand. That's sloppy second.
Yeah.
Right? So in Hebrews chapter 8, this is where God absolutely nails it. He is so strong on this, and he just wants to get something across. Now, I'm going to read from the Message paraphrase just for this section as well, because it really brings out something. It says, Jesus' priestly work far surpasses what these other priests did in the Old Testament, since he's working from a better plan or a better covenant. If the first covenant had not worked or had worked out, a second covenant would not be needed. But we know the first was found wanting because God said, this is what now, these are God's words. Heads up. Kind of the sound is, look. Here's a heads up.
Heads up.
Now when somebody yells heads up to you, what do you do? You look up, right? sometimes can be a dangerous thing. Heads up. A lot of times, you should have just went down, but heads up means heads up. So God's not saying heads up, but all of a sudden something's flying at you. He wants you to see it. Heads up, because something's happening. He goes, the day is coming when I'll set up a new plan for dealing. And here he uses Israel and Judah, but it's for the church, for us as well. He says, I'll throw out the old plan. And now what was that old plan? Having somebody stand in the gap between God and man. That's part of it. He said, I'm throwing that out. That I set up with their ancestors when I led them by hand out of Egypt. They didn't keep their part of the bargain, so I looked away and let it go. This new plan I'm making with Israel isn't going to be written on paper, isn't going to be chiseled in stone. This time I'm writing out the plan in them, carving it on the lining of their hearts. I'll be their God and they'll be my people. They won't go to school to learn about me or buy a book called God in 5 Easy Lessons. They'll all get to know me firsthand. Say firsthand. Man, I love firsthand information. I love firsthand relationship. And how sad would it be if I had to get my brother Marcel to tell me how Jamie was doing this morning? I'm married. I'm in covenant with this woman. And I got to go, hey, can you ask Jamie? Like, you know, kind of nervous about it. Like, she makes my hands clammy still. How's she doing? Can I get her anything? And he goes over there. Yeah. And because he wouldn't even properly relay the message. He'd go, hey, my other older dorky brother wants to know, his hands are clammy or something, but do you need anything? Right? That's not how I said it. That's not what I said. I was excited. I said, my hands clam up when I think of her. And I just want to know, does she need anything? So the message is messed up. Right? This is what God is saying, firsthand information. So you can hear God for yourself. I know we know this, but don't become familiar with it. First-hand information. That's what's the difference between some people, as we talked last week. I'm not going to get into detail. But even when you can tell when people just completely come into worship, because some people have first-hand information, others don't. That's hands down the biggest difference. That's the biggest gap is between people know some things and then people know some things. I know where I came from. That's why I lift my hands easily, right? Okay, anyways, that's not part of my message. They'll all get to know me firsthand, the little and the big, the small and the great. They'll get to know me by being kindly forgiven with the slate of their sins forever wiped clean. How can we know them firsthand? Is because they've been kindly forgiven. The slate of their sin has been completely wiped out. That's why you can know them. You stand as if you've never done a thing wrong. That's why he can share with you. God can't talk to an unrighteous human being. But guess what? Who is that? That ain't us. Why? Because he made you clean. He made you new. How? By the precious blood of Jesus that was shed. He cleansed you for eternity. Now when God looks at you, he goes, I see no fault with you. I see no wrong in you. This is who I am. This is what I'm all about. Right? And so what we don't have to do is you don't have to buy this book, God in 5 Easy Lessons. You can put that aside and God himself is going to speak directly to you. Yeah. Woo! So, now when God speaks to you, man, that changes everything. Yeah. I mean, I'm not just saying like, I'm not talking about out here, but have you ever been like prompted on the inside where the Spirit of God is saying something on the inside of you? Yeah. Oh man, when he speaks, right? And I'm not saying you have to get these goose pimples every time. Sometimes it's just that's what happened to me this past week. I was challenged in an awesome way. Because listen, I don't want to stay the same. Yeah. Lord, you guys don't want me to stay the same. I'd be boring. We had some quality days this past week with Shalina. She came and she knows just what to say at the right time. And the very last verse of Hebrews 8, it says, by coming up with a new plan, a new covenant between God and his people, God put the old plan on the shelf, and there it stays, gathering dust. Wow. So it's no longer, this old plan is done. It's finito. God doesn't look at it anymore. It's finished, right? Jesus, he didn't come to get rid of it. He came to fulfill it, and that's what he did. Right. So Jesus is knocking on your door. You must open it. You must make room for him. You must be willing to have a conversation with him. And so this morning, this is what we're going to talk about. We're simply, I mean, yes, I'm going to be speaking, but I want you on the inside just to search your heart on this. Because we're going to talk about something it's good, but open the door, have a conversation with him about it. See where you are with it, and so that we can move forward. Cool? All right, so sold out. Again, my beautiful wife told me, or told us all here, what does it mean to be sold out, the definition. I'm going to read them out to you again, and we're going to cover one area. It means to be completely committed. It means devoted, invested and engaged to a cause, to have no reserves about the decision that you are making, willing to go anywhere, to do anything, and give everything. So the word we're going to focus in on this morning is the word devoted. Now the word devoted, I looked at a couple of things, just wanted to really kind of pull everything out of it. And it means to be loyal, it means to be faithful, it means to be true, it means to be constant, committed, and dedicated. Now we all want God to be devoted to us. We want God to be faithful, we want God to be loyal, we want God to be steadfast, we want Him to be committed, we want Him to be consistent in everything He does, right? Right, you don't want an inconsistent God, right? We want Him to be consistent in everything that He does. Well, here's the question. We want that from Him, but are we really willing to do that towards Him?
Right.
That's kind of the separation. Okay, God, you be faithful. And He's looking, hey, are you faithful? Right, so it's a two-way street, right? It's not just gimme, gimme, gimme. There's also our part of bringing our supply in that as well. So now, where does devotedness begin? If you go to your Bibles, Luke 16:10, I want you just to see this. And I'm going to role play some things for you here in a little bit. And I have actually some donut on there. That's cool. Max, I have a... Okay. Luke 16:10. So where does devotedness begin? So because I'm not just going to say, oh yeah, be devoted. Oh, that's great. No, but practically, how do I start being devoted? Because if you're faithful or if you're devoted in this one area, the others will follow.
Right.
Right? That's kind of how this thing works. A lot of times we're trying to be devoted. Okay, if I'm just devoted in my prayer time. There's nothing wrong with that. That's good. But listen, if you can take care of this one area, say one area.
One area.
If you do this one area, other areas will actually fall into place. Yeah. And I'm going to prove that to you.
Yeah.
Right? So you can say, oh, I'm trying to get devoted in even coming to church. That's good. That's great. We're supposed to come gather together. That's what the Bible says to do. So we do it. It's not just about your prayer time, my time in worship. It's we want to be devoted in this area and the rest will follow. So if you're trying to struggling, oh man, how come I'm not seeing I'm quite devoted or as faithful in some of these areas? We're going to start here and watch it change your life. It will. It absolutely will. Now, it's not necessarily going to be like, some brand new thing. You may have heard of it. It may be some kind of sensitive for you, but we're going to talk about it because we've got to talk about it.
Bring it on.
So Luke 16:10. I really like talking about awkward things. I really do. I really do. Why? Because the world, the more quiet things are, the more confusion the enemy can bring to people's minds, and all of a sudden they're trying to figure life out, and they're missing it, and they're all, then you got these religious ideas, and it's just blah. So let's just find out what Jesus said.
Right.
We'll do what Jesus said. When we do that, then life makes sense, and we'll just continue on this walk with Him. Right? Because again, I'm committed. I'm saying, Lord, I'm opening my heart. You're standing at the door knocking. Here I am. You can have every area in me, and this is a huge area.
Yes.
Okay. Luke 16:10, it says, if you are faithful... Other translations actually say devoted in the little things. You will be faithful in the larger ones.
Yeah.
But if you are dishonest in the little things, you won't be honest with greater responsibilities. So again, what do we want? Greater responsibilities.
Right.
We kind of look, okay, I want to have a bigger influence in my job. I want to have a bigger influence in my family. Are you faithful in the little things? Because if you're faithful or devoted in the little things, more is added to you. Right? Sometimes people are asking way above their faithfulness level. I want this. I want to have that. I want to see this. Yeah, but are you faithful in this area? Well, no. Well, what makes you think you can be faithful in that? Now, I'll give you a classic example. Jamie and I, when we were youth pastoring, we had a gentleman that came and was part of our leadership team for a little while. And he made this statement to me, and I'll never forget it because I wanted to punch him. Because at this time, his main role was really to kind of, you know, do some lighting, help with, you know, some just different areas like that. Just areas to do the lighting, kind of some sound stuff, just around here like this. And he came up to me and said, Pastor Joel, when will you let me preach? I said, preach? You want to preach? I said, why do you want to preach? He said, well, I've just been doing all this little stuff. It's not really doing anything. I said, wait a minute. If you can turn on a light switch properly, then we'll talk about you behind the pulpit. And it kind of made it was a little bit of a didn't really go over that well. Wish it did, but it didn't. But you get those types of things. Why can't I just do something big? Well, is your lawn looked after? Like, why can't I just, why can't I be doing this thing? Well, does your bed look like you've been made in it? Like, it look, just little things. So this question came up, and that kind of started a whole thing in me going, okay, I got to see this. I want to check this thing out, and I want to actually go before the Lord to make sure, okay, Lord, I'm asking you, we want to reach Canada. And at the same time, does he go, how about, take care of your family first?
Right?
So we're wanting the big Moses vision by neglecting also the little responsibilities that we've been given. Right? Because to whom much is given, much is required. So again, this is the area that we're going to talk about this morning. And I promise you, if you'll open the door, the Spirit of God will talk to you. Because I know this week he talked to me. And if he's talking to me about it, he's talking to you about it. I know that. Matthew chapter 6, 24. So hold your place in Luke 16. Because we're going to come back to that at some point. But Matthew chapter 6, I want you to look here at verse 24.
Come on.
All right, you there?
Yeah.
Say, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
I'm ready. Okay. Let's read this. It says, no one can serve two masters. Say, no one.
No one.
No one. Doesn't matter how cute you are. Doesn't matter how buff you think you are. Doesn't matter how cool your hairdo is. No one, doesn't matter how smart you are, no one can serve two masters. You can't. And then Jesus lays out, here it is. For you will hate one and love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money. Other translation, I like it better. You cannot serve God and money. Now, I love this, but God didn't even put himself with Satan. What is Satan? He's defeated. And once you get born again, the temptation to serve the devil is completely gone. That guy's a loser. I don't want to hang around with him or his crew. It's just ridiculous. But he says, you cannot serve God and you cannot serve money. Now, this is what we're going to talk about this morning is money. Because if we can get the money thing sorted out properly and what put money in this proper place, your life will go in the proper direction as well. Now, I know lots of us are good in it, but this is just a refresher course for some of us. And we just want to get this sorted out because we've got to talk about this. I've heard way too many comments, the tithe and things like, you guys just want my money. Yes and no. That's not what it's about. It's about God getting access to you. Right? That's what it's about. Because he wants to be devoted. Remember what he said in 2 Chronicles 16:9? He wants to show himself strong on those whose hearts are fully committed. You cannot be fully committed to God if you're still holding on to your wallet.
That's right.
It's impossible. So this past week, I was challenged. Yay, I was stretched. So I want to just quick testimony what happened for Jamie and I. And I'm sure you guys had that too. But we were at this conference, and they took up offering after offering after offering. Like, I'm not kidding. There's a lot of offerings. And so you kind of go, ooh, Lord. Like, but every time he went and he ministered this message, it wasn't like, we're trying to get your money. That's not it at all. I caught the heart for what money is. And I know we all know the Christian answer to it is to advance the gospel. Yes, that's absolutely true. But it's so much deeper than that. And part of it was, and so, Jamie and I, what we found ourselves, we're givers. That's who we are. God loves a cheerful giver. So that's what we do. That's who we are. But I found myself at this meeting being stretched.
Yeah.
Like, stretched. Like, when you have, I don't know, was it 4 offerings a day?
At least,
something like that. And all of a sudden, they would make this offering. And I found myself, he just really, the emphasis was, don't let money have you. You have the money. And so I found myself, we sowed the first thing. Yeah, we sowed. That's what we do, man. Opportunity to give, we're going to take it. And so we gave an amount that was, we can do this. And it's not about the amount. But we said, this is, because he made this statement. If you don't notice your giving, what do you think, do you think the Lord's going to notice it? That challenged me. And I like being challenged. So as we sat there, all of a sudden we gave that. And the next day we're like, man, that was good. And then we came back and he started ministering again. And he started sharing some of these things that you're wanting to receive revelation knowledge from God. When you receive the word, you want revelation from God. And we're like, yeah, that's what we want. He said, that's impossible without you giving your giving. It's like, okay. So we're sitting there and I'm hearing all this. And on the inside, I'm going, woo. Like, I'm feeling this stretch going on. Because the first thing that happens with a lot of people when they talk about money, the first thing is people get offended like that.
Yeah.
Just like that. Why? Because, well, Jesus, we'll talk about this later, but where your treasure is, there your heart is also. So we're hitting a really deep issue when your money, when money's being talked about. I know this. And I was really asking the Lord, how do I approach something like this to a group of people that understand it, and maybe some don't, maybe some have questions about it. How do I do this with honor, not to say, okay, we're trying to get your money. That's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to get God access to these doors. We want God access to these doors. Now, you cannot have a clear revival without giving. People can talk about revival all you want. You can say, oh yeah, things were happening, things were going, healing was taking. You can say that all you want, but if there is not a financial breakthrough in that as well, it's not a revival.
Yeah.
It's a strong emphasis on this area, which is fantastic, but a true revival includes the money aspect of it. And I'm not just talking revival with people, I want it on the inside of me. Now, something happened in me, something broke in me this past week, and I'm excited about. And I just knew, okay, Lord, I want to go to the next level, and it was this giving thing. So when the opportunity came again, Jamie and I, we looked at each other and we were like, okay, we already gave what we considered a pretty good offering from our heart. And all of a sudden, the thing came around again. I looked at her, I was like, man, we ain't done yet. And she looked at me and she kind of grabbed her chair like. And all of a sudden, like, some of these scriptures are rolling around on the inside of me. You cannot serve God and money. I'm like, I know, but. So we took a leap of faith this past week, and we said, all of a sudden, something else was said, and we just got stirred up in our hearts. We said, Lord, we're not going to let this thing control us anymore. It has no more place in our life where money tells me what I can and cannot do. I'm going to tell it what to do now. So what we did is we went up there by faith. Oh, you want to say something? You can come up here. You can tell. Oh, Jamie's got her part. So we went up there and we brought our offering down there and we ran up to the front. We held hands and the whole way down I was like, woo! 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 And at the same time we said, Lord, no, we're trusting you with this. There it is. Gone! And then we just ran away. Okay, go ahead, share your part.
A side note, when you go to a meeting in the United States of America that has a different currency than you.
Yeah, that's also included.
Yeah. Oh, you're going to be challenged. Yeah. Because we both had, and this happens to Joel and I often, because since we got married, we set our hearts in agreement. We're going to be generous, and God will tell him an amount and me an amount, and it will always be the same, right? And So I thought that we had the amount in Canadian dollars, but...
Oh, no.
Oh, we get home and Joel's like, oh, yeah, you're even more challenged when you give in American dollars. I'm like, I thought we agreed on Canadian... Anyway,
We're in agreement now.
We are. We're in agreement. Oh, man, I just got to share this because... You guys, I just feel like I'm going to burst inside. I'm like, everything you're saying, this is so good. And these, I didn't even know you're talking to money, and I just want to share my side of that. It's really good, I promise.
Yeah. It's probably better. Go for it.
Two statements that were said there that really challenged me. And I just want to give, because if you're sitting in this seat and you're like, there's something in you that's like, why are they talking about money? I can tell you I have been there. I have been there, and it is just, all it is just a growing and a stretching period of you getting in the Word and finding out what God says about money, not what man or some church has taught you about money.
Yeah.
So if you're struggling right now, I can promise you, you can get set free, and it's in the Word, and it's all good. When you can be generous with your money, we can be generous with your money, and it will not have a hold on you. It will set you free from the fear of lack. So giving will set you free from that fear of lack. And then also, this is so good. If you're thinking about what someone or some church or some ministry that God told you to give to is going to do with the money you're giving, you haven't turned it loose. Oh, wow, because the offerings that God prompted us to give in had to do with the meetings that we were at. And then the next day's offerings were a missions budget. And I can tell you, I struggled in my heart. I was like, well, I want to give in that mission. I want to give in that missions one. And God said, this statement came out, and I thought, oh, I have not. This is not real giving if I'm, like, putting it in. And I'm like, but what are you doing? No, that's not it.
Great.
Anyway, so that's what set me free.
That's what you set you free. No, that's so true. So good. And so we're going to just continue on with that. But just to go back with this, Mark 6:24 says, no man can serve two masters. Now, we might as well come to grips on this. And the reality is someone or something owns you. Yeah. Now, if you can just take on this mindset, somebody, something owns me. Wow. You're owned. Right? You don't have your free, like, yes, you have free will, but someone or something is owning you. Yeah. Right? You're not just walking around, oh, it's just Joel living his life. No, either someone or something is owning you and dictating to you what you do in this life. Right? We're doing okay?
Yeah, this is good.
Okay, all right. I'm just making sure. So the question goes back to, now we have to choose who we serve. Right? Jesus threw out this statement, and again, it's a choice now, who do we serve? Now, the word serve, it means to work for and to take orders from a superior, which makes you a slave, to perform duties or services. Right? Do I need to say that again? This is who you and I are. We're here to work for and take orders from a superior. I'm under authority. Right? You're under authority. Yes, and all, the head of all of this thing is God. Yeah. He makes, which makes you a slave, to perform duties or services. Now, I wanted just to kind of illustrate this to you a little bit. So I'm going to be your waiter or your server. And I'm glad I got a nice, clean, white one. That's good. And this is an old school family of faith church one.
Oh, yeah.
I'll turn it this way. There we go. Okay. And I didn't say, but in next month, we're Impact Life Church, y'all. So it's going to be a little different. Okay. Now, here I am in my apron. This is what my wife dreamt that I would be like, and here I am. Showing her this is what it's all about. I don't even know how to tie the thing back here. Can someone lace me? I don't know. We'll just do this kamikaze style. All right. So, it's kind of reefing on my neck here. How do you do this? There it is. Okay. We're good. Hi, Joel Huizing. How may I serve you? Now, let me just start off with this statement. When I serve God, I serve people. When I serve money, I serve myself.
Wow.
That's the biggest difference between the two. When I'm serving God, I'm serving others. I don't care how anybody else thinks about me. I don't care what anybody else says about me. Because when I'm serving God, I'm so focused on serving Him that what anybody else says, it really doesn't matter. Right? I could look ridiculous in this thing, but it doesn't matter. Right, but when I'm serving money, I am very conscious of what other people are saying about me and how I dress, how I look, how things are. There's almost that prestige of life then, right? So you and I, we have to choose who we serve. Now, Joshua 24:25 is a very popular scripture. Joshua said this to the Israelites at the time. He said, choose for yourself this day who you will serve. So it's a choice. You have to choose who you're going to serve. For them, they had idols. They had different things that they listed off that they other people were serving, and they had to make a choice. Is it God or is it some other idol?
Yeah.
Right? Well, it's the same way. Is it God or is it money, which is an idol? What am I serving? Who am I going to serve? Now, the question is, again, I'm just asking questions for you just to think about it. Who or what do I serve? Who or what is giving you orders? Who or what is telling you what you cannot and can do? Who or what is running your life? How do you make decisions? What decisions, like when you come across something, what determines or what puts you over the edge that this is what we're going to do or not going to do? And lastly is, where is your money? Where is it? I mean, this is something that, you know, Jamie and I, we do a lot of different things like that. This may be some kind of practical, but it'll help. I had to kind of look back over our giving areas, and I had to look, okay, I want to make sure that where I'm giving is where I want it to go. Right? Sometimes it's so easy just to kind of flash the plastic. But on purpose, intentionally, where is my money going? Where am I honestly putting it? Because where I'm putting it, I'm actually directing my heart to go there. Right? So where am I putting it? Is it in the shopping? Okay, my heart's going to be at Bower Mall. Sounds funny, but that's the truth. That's why people have these addictions. Is it at Tim Hortons? Because guess what? Your heart's at Tim Hortons. And a lot of Canadians' heart is in Tim Hortons.
Yeah.
It could be different areas like that. But when it's focused on the church and the kingdom of God, your heart's there. Because Pastor Jamie said something last week that I just, like, I heard her say, and something just kind of went off on the inside of me, and I wanted to kind of find that out. She said, just fall in love with the church again. How do you do that? With your finances.
Wow.
If you're like, man, I have a hard time committing, listen, this will help.
Yeah.
Because wherever you put it, your finances, that's where your heart's going to be. I just want to love the church. I want to be for what the church is doing. Okay, well, it starts in this area. What I'm saying is, like, it's there. And I'm not apologizing for it, but what I want to do is I want to get this across, because the time is short.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what we want to do is we want to keep life in its proper perspective by keeping money in its proper place, which is second place.
Yeah.
Now, let's just say, for example, can I have, would you two come up here for a sec? I need, yeah, Shalina and Eric, I'll just get you guys to each grab a chair. And there's that, could you put that on your, just so everybody kind of sees. Eric, you're going to be God.
Yes.
All right, and she's money, 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 money. All right, so, and again, in life, who are we? You basically look like me in life, just so y'all know. You may not see it, it could be an invisible apron, but you got one on. All right, this is how you and I look, and this is what we're doing every moment of every day, is we're walking around like this. Somebody dings, and we right away will respond. So let's just start off with God here for a moment. Because as I said, if you serve God, who are we actually serving?
People.
When we serve God, we are actually, in fact, serving people. So let's just say, for an example, you know, your life is going on and God rings. Yes, sir. What can I do for you? And he would give some instruction. He would say, I would really like to see this happen in your life. My response is, yes, sir, love to do that. And whenever he tells me to do something, listen, every time he says something for me to do, it will benefit me, but it will also benefit you. It has to, because what is God all about? You cannot love God without loving people. 1 John tells us that very clearly. Everything about God is God's about people. Whew. Right? So when I'm serving God, and you know what? The world can be saying things. The world could be doing different things. But if I'm so focused, Lord, I'm here. I want to serve. What would you have me do, Lord? What would you have me do? I'm so focused on this. They can say whatever they want. Like, this is what happened to me when I, in college, end of high school, going into college. I had no Christian friends that I knew of. They're all, like, my life was so focused on the other outside here, you know, doing life. And so every time, yes, I wanted to serve God, but to be honest, every time that he rang, I didn't answer. He knocked, I had no interest. Why? Because I was more concerned what other people thought. So as a result, I'm actually serving myself. You cannot serve money and serve people. It's impossible. Right? So Eric, you just fling that over to Shalina. Shalina, all of a sudden we're walking around, you're doing your thing. Again, you look like this. You're walking and you're living life like this, and money rings. Oh, yes, money. Yes, I got a paycheck. Hey, what do you need? Do you need some new clothes?
Chocolate.
We got to get some chocolate. Oh, man, I'm craving some good old chocolate. Yeah. Oh, hey, here you go, money. And who is benefiting from this? Moi. Is money benefiting it from it? No, it's just getting flung around. Oh, this is some good stuff. And money, anything else that you, I love, here is the thing. Again, what is Matthew 6:24, if you will love one, you will. That's a strong word. It means to loathe, to discredit, to have nothing to do with. And then if you're devoted to one, you will be unfaithful. You'll actually despise the other. It means to treat lightly. So that's why some people treat God lightly. Why? It's because they're here. But I love God. We're actually here. So money rings, and you're right here, and you go, okay, what do you need? Paycheck just got around the corner. Oh, man, what do you think? What should we do with this thing?
New suit. Don't worry about tithing.
No tithing.
Just a new suit. Because you need that.
Yeah. Okay, what else?
Chocolate again,
of course.
A hamburger. And your sons want new toys.
Yes, they do. All right, here I go on my list. And meanwhile, I'm going out doing all these things. I'm just showing where my heart actually is. And God is ringing. And here's the thing, I'm so focused on this stuff over here, I'm so focused on serving myself, I can't even hear that ring anymore. The ring is just a silent thing now. He's quick. Now let me just go back here to God. So now we're back here with God. God rings, and listen, I'm money sits, I'm free of money, the free of thinking about, okay, I gotta make money, I gotta get all this money. I'm so focused on God that when God rings, oh man, here, sir, what can I do for you?
I want you to love people.
I want you to love people. Okay, that's a classic God answer, right? But in this, now I want you to go to Luke 16. If you guys could just stay here for a few more minutes. Luke 16, go just turn there for a sec. I hope this is helping. Sorry, Luke 12. Sorry, I meant Luke 12. Luke 12, chapter 12, verse 22. So I want to show you this just for a sec, because where things start changing in your life. So Jesus made this statement, you cannot serve God and money. And then right afterwards, he went into this whole thing about the cares of this world. So if your care is no longer with finances, with money, then this is what you and I have to do. Because listen, if money is still something that controls you, then you're going to worry about your clothes. You're going to worry about your food. You're going to worry about what you're going to wear. You're going to worry about what people think of you. You're going to worry about all those things. But if you choose that God, you're going to serve God, then we're going to read this right here, verse 22, it says, turning his disciples, Jesus said, that is why I tell you, do not worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food to eat or enough clothes to wear, for life is more than food and your body is more than clothing. Look at the birds. Everybody say, look at the birds. Why did God not say, look at the giraffes? Look at the rhino. Because you got to drive an hour and a half to a zoo to find a rhino anywhere around here. Freeze their butt off in this country. He says, look at the birds. Why? Because there's birds everywhere. There's a ton of them. When you walk outside, you'll probably see a black crow. That's all that survives around this time of year. All right. Look at the birds. They don't plant. Here's the thing. Listen, they don't plant or harvest. Plant or harvest. What is that? Sowing. All right. Okay. Or store food in barns. For God feeds them. And you are far more valuable to him than any bird. Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And if worry can accomplish a little thing like that, what's the use of worrying over bigger things? Look at the lilies, the flowers, and how they grow. They don't work to make their clothing. Yet Solomon, in all of his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for flowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So obviously, we can develop our faith in this. Verse 29, don't be concerned about what to eat and what to drink. Don't worry about such things, for these things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers all over the world. But your Father already knows your needs, so seek the kingdom of God above all else, and he will give you everything you need. Now, what I heard this past week, notice this, you don't even need to use your faith for this. You don't even need to use your faith for it. What is this saying? All these things will just be added to you. So we spend our time serving right here. We spend our time, we are opening the door every time the Father says something. Man, hey, I want you to sow a seed in this person's life. I want you to go be part of over here. I want you to go serve over here. I want you to go get involved over here. The result is, we're serving this master. What did Jesus say the result is? All of these things what? Things that this person is craving, is wanting so bad, is wanting to be part of, is wanting to see, wanting to hold on to and purchase with everything they got. He said, if you just spend your time serving this, serving God right here, all those things are added to you. Added. Not taken away. Added. Added. Everybody say added. What does that mean? Here. Added to you. For what? I didn't have to buy the thing. That's how it works. That's what God is all about. And if you have to buy it, he'll get supply the money for it. But he's saying, if you're so caught up in serving money, you're going to waste your entire life wondering, what am I going to wear? What am I going to eat? How am I going to raise my kids? How am I going to pay for this new vehicle? Yeah. How am I going to get the house? How am I going to get this established? How am I going to get that promotion? How am I going to get that new job at work? You're so focused on yourself that the word actually has no place in you anymore. Now what you are your own God trying to make life work. It doesn't work that way. And it's frustrating. People are burnt out. Christians are wondering where God is. In the meantime, God's like, I'm ringing. Where are you at? He doesn't serve us. We serve him. Now, that's the biggest thing. And what we're trying to do with money is we're trying to run our show by, you know, this is where my money goes. But meanwhile, all along, money's actually got you in its grasp. Yeah. It's holding you just like this, and it's telling you what you can and cannot do. Oh, yeah, you know, it's Sunday morning again. They're probably going to receive a tithe and offering. But, you know, we just spent a lot of money this past week at shopping, and, man, we just bought a brand new minivan. Yeah. We have no time for that anymore. So the result is we're actually going to stop doing something with God because of a need that I already have met for myself. You see the problem? Okay, you guys can thank you very much. Whew. Okay, you can give them a hand. They did a great job up there. thank you. So let's look again at verse 32. Verse 31, it says, seek the kingdom of God above all else, and he will give you everything you need. Church, do we trust him in that? Like, listen, it's easier said than done. But he said, the kingdom of God above all else, and he will give you everything you need. He'll give it to you. Yeah. Now, we got to know God like this. We have to know him like this. Because for the most part, we're still trying to be our own provider. How do I know this? Well, this past week, I actually got a revelation that I'm still trying to provide for my own self. How so? By holding on to money. Yeah. Every time the opportunity, we'd give. But man, to the point where I'm actually completely free of it, you know what? Yeah, here, take this. There's more of that. The more that I let go of it, I found the more free I got on the inside. Yeah. It's a completely different operation than the world. I liked how, you know, Dave Hubschman always said, you know, the world base of their system is you save all you get, you get, or what does it say? You save all you can all you get, and then you sit on the can. That's the world system of doing it. But God's system on how he operates is done by giving. This is who he's like. For God so loved the world that he gave. The heaven went bankrupt for you and I. That's his role. That's who he is. He gave everything he had. He sold everything he had, and he gave Jesus so that he could reap you and I. That's what the Father's like. So listen, we're asking God, yeah, Lord, we thank you for Jesus. We expected him to come. He didn't have to. He's devoted to you and I. He's devoted. Yeah. So he's like, man, I'm sold out to y'all. Here you go. Here you go. Here you go. Here you go. Here's everything. And not only that too, but he's already given us everything that pertains to life and godliness, 1 Peter 1:3 says. We already got it. You don't have to try to, like, and actually one of the things in this passage is that seek first the kingdom of God. Well, you don't actually have to seek it because you already got it on the inside of you. Yep. So what we're doing is we're realizing the kingdom is in me. Now, what does that mean? I already have everything I'll ever need. Amen. He's already put it there. It's already there. So what do I need to do now? I need to learn and understand how to release what already he's put inside of me so it comes out into my everyday life. And it's impossible to see if money's still owning me. Why? Let's continue reading verse 32. This is so good. Jesus said, don't be afraid, little flock. Isn't that, when I read this, I was looking over this last night and just thinking about it. Little flock. That's just how he sees it. Just like a little sheep. Like my son carries a little, his little baby. Right, everywhere he goes, we play hockey with it, baby. We play soccer with it. I got my baby. Like he loves this little guy. He treats it as a little flock. Baby, he walks around with it. Well, the same way you have a heavenly father that's just, come here, buddy. Come here, baby, come here. And he'll bring you in his arm. And then he says, "For it gives your father great happiness to give you the kingdom." Now, what I'm talking about here doesn't just refer to stuff. It refers to even your family. A lot of you believe in God for your family. Well, again, the question is, who do you serve? Because again, if you're serving, that's serving money, or you're serving God, the option's still there. Well, how does it work? I don't want to go into the details on it, but it just does. God didn't put anything else. Are you going to serve me, or are you going to serve your husband? You're going to serve me, or you're going to serve your wife? You're going to serve me, or you're going to serve your kids? It's me and money. Yeah. That's the composing force.
Yeah.
Okay. Verse 33. Note 32, don't be afraid, little flock, for it gives your father great happiness to give you the kingdom. Verse 34, so wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will be also. Yeah. I have gotten so turned on to the church. I've fallen in complete love with the church. How? By letting money not control where I give. It doesn't say, oh, you know what, your credit card's maxed out. You better not give. No, that does not talk to me. Now, I'm not just saying I just, you know, throw all that stuff around. I'm listening to what he says. If he says, yeah, Joel, I want you to give that, yes, sir, done. To that point where he says, I want you to give $1 million, yes, sir, not even bat an eye. Yeah. Can you do that? Wow. Can all of a sudden, when the Lord says, hey, I want you to, $100, would you sow that $100 into somebody? Ooh, it's really not a good time for me right now, Lord. I just bought a Colica Pass, and that was already 45. It's just not working real good for me. Money has you. It's got you. It's so subtle, but it has you. When the Lord's just able to say, hey, I want you to drop 50 grand, bam, it's just as if it's not even yours to begin with. It's not even yours to begin with, right? Now here, let me just talk about, this is where we got to trust God on this, but where do people get in trouble? Where does this whole money thing get in trouble? Go to 1 Timothy chapter 6, please. I trust this is helping you. Okay. I don't want anything holding me back from being able to serve God effectively. I want the moment he even knocks on the door, the moment he rings a bell, I am there. So, Lord, I'm your man. What do you need? That's sold out. Listen, there's an entire nation that needs you and I. The message that we have, they need it. They need to hear this gospel, right? And what is the good news of the gospel? Well, Jesus said, I came to proclaim the good news to the poor. What is the good news to a poor man? You don't have to be poor anymore. So God's not asking you to be poor. That's not it. He wants you blessed, extremely rich, but he doesn't want riches having you. That's the whole thing. It doesn't work that way. Because if riches have you, then God doesn't have you. That's the absolute truth about it. There's no wiggle room around it. That's just what it is. And so that's one thing that I found for myself. Lord, I've been saying to the Lord, Lord, I'm sold out to you. I've been just speaking that to myself. I've been talking to the Lord. Lord, I'm committed to your work. I'm committed to serving you. And this past week, he stirred me up. Well, finances have a little bit of you, Joel. Oh, no, they don't. Lord, I tithe. I give. This is what I do. I give. And anytime an opportunity comes for send a special offering, we are givers. That's what we do. He said, yeah, but it needs to grow a little more. It just needs, there's a few things that are still holding on to you. Finances flat out, they're still controlling what you do and what you can't do. Oh, okay. That's a problem. Because if I'm looking and God asks, say, okay, I want to go, we need another building here at the family, we need another building for Impact Life Church. You go, oh, you know what, Lord, it's not the best time. No. Yes, sir.
Right. Yeah,
yeah. Why? So we're able to reach more people. Oh, I need you to help this person out over here. It's not, well, you know what, God, it's not really the best time. It's when he leads, yes, sir. Now, I'm not just saying everybody that comes and says, like, you know, you're going to get five people that say, oh, you know what, the Lord told me you're supposed to give me $100 after the service. That doesn't work that way. That's not what I'm saying. It's as he leads you, right? As he's knocking and as he's saying, hey, I need you to do this. It's not, well, not somebody else saying, well, you know, God loves you, but I got a plan for your life. Right, Mr. Barry? It's whenever he calls, it's, yes, I'm ready. What do you need me to do? And we see that in the Bible, David was a prime example. Right? In the offering to the temple, this past week, it was in U.S. dollars, he gave $5 billion in his first offering. And he said, I'll do even more than that. And not only that, but then as a result, his mighty men, which were under his leadership, they came and they gave $8 billion altogether collectively in one offering. Now, what's the result? That's the leadership style of it. So, men, husbands in your home, you got to set that tone. You got to make that set. This is where our money goes. This is who we are. And as a result, my kids are going to be blessed because of it.
Not only that,
my kids are going to have a relationship, this intimacy with God, because of how we're choosing and we're making a decision to put our finances. Now, we can't buy salvation. You can't buy those things, but it sure does give God access into your life. That's a lot of time. That's the thing that's holding people back more than anything else is this financial realm. And it absolutely just sucks everything out. It stops God from coming in. And God needs access to every part of you. Not just, okay, yeah, he wants you to talk to your wife a little better. Yes. He wants you to treat your kids with kindness and love. Yes. All that stuff is true. But if we don't have this one aspect down, forget the rest. Might as well forget. You can pray all you want. Lord, I need peace in my home. But if you got this down pat, things will just be added to you. I'm pleading with you. I want you to grasp this. Like you, I know you already do this. What I'm saying is I want us to see it in a greater light. This is your next level. You're wondering, how do I go in my next relationship with God? Give him your wallet. We say, God, control my life. I give you my life. Does he have your wallet? When you go into your banking account and you're in your service.ca and you're doing your different things, do you talk to him about it? That's what I've just started doing. I said, okay, Lord, how does this look? Where do you want some of this money to shift? Where do you want this money to go? Because I found out money is used for two things. How do I say this? Sowing is for giving. And sowing, how do I say this? I want to make it sound right. It's for giving, and it's for, I forgot what I was going to say. I had a brain fart. But I know what money that is saved is money that doesn't have a vision for it yet. Yeah. Right? There's never even a point to, like, money, yes, that's good to save, but it's because there's not a vision yet for it. Right? So what the purpose of money is simply to get in, but it goes out.
Yeah.
That's what we want to do with it. Continual. Now, 1 Timothy chapter 6. Verse 10, this is where people get in trouble of it. It says, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Not money. Money isn't evil.
Yeah, that's right.
Right? Everybody say it with me. Money
isn't evil.
Money isn't evil. The love of money is evil.
Yeah, right?
Right? And some people, craving money, have wandered from the truth, from the true faith, and pierced themselves with many sorrows. Now look at 17. So teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money, which is so unreliable. Their trust should be in God, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. Tell them to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works and generous to those in need, always being ready to share with others. By doing this, they will be storing up their treasure as a good foundation for the future so that they may experience true life. True life. See, what a lot of people are trying to do, they're trying to say, oh yeah, I have life, but they're still holding on to their money. It's a form of life. True life is nothing owns me. Nothing controls me. Every time God says for something me to do something, yes, I'm on it. He wants me on that mission trip, yes, I'll do it. It's not a if, and we'll see how it works out. So let's all stand up together. Now I want to make this confession. Was this helpful for you?
Yeah.
It was a little. I know it's a little different, but every time we talk about sold out, it's so good. We can see all the things that God wants to do and what God will do to a sold out person. That's so good. But the other part of it is, Lord, what do you need from us?
Yeah.
And we just wanted to share with what was on our heart that happened this past week with you as well. Mm-hmm. But I want you just to say this out with me. I settle this issue right now.
I adjust
my financial attitude.
I do not
serve money.
I am not a slave to money.
I serve God.
Money serves me.
I do not work for money.
Money works for me.
Money doesn't control me.
I control money.
Money doesn't rule me.
I rule money.
Money doesn't dominate me.
I dominate money.
I fearlessly tithe
and give
when I'm told.
I boldly give
as I'm led.
Money?
No. Like, look at it.
Money.
Think about it. In your pocket. If you got a wallet, I did this with my wallet. Oh, I got a $5 bill. Cool. You guys, so I want you to look at this thing. Because it's talking. You're only $5. You can only get a Slurpee. But when I give it, it produces a whole lot more. So I want you just to, if you don't have your wallet, just look. You got your wallet, just look at it for a moment. Because we gotta let them know who's boss. Because listen, I'm telling you, on either end, they're both ringing. It's not like money shuts up. Right? Oh, I'm serving God. Money is still, we have needs. Love us. Spend time with us. We'll have so much fun together. It's still talking. And meanwhile, God's like, no, don't pay any attention to that. You focus on me. you stay with me. You stay connected to me. And when I ring, you come. And every time that rings, that's what I want to get to. He rings, bam, I'm right here. Money rings, I go, oh, I got no time for you. I already sold you. I already gave you away. I don't want it to own me. So look at this thing. Talk to it. Money.
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 You
obey
me.
Me.
Now I know it looks silly, but look at it again. Money.
Money.
You
obey
me. You obey me. This doesn't dictate what I can and cannot have. You obey me. So when I place you, or when I sow you in a bucket, when I sow you into somebody's life, you produce a harvest for me. You go and you make a great harvest for me. And not only that, but you help that other person that's in need right now. You sow that, and that money now, there's no strings attached. It simply just goes, and you let go. There's not a strings attached. Now what they do with it, that's between him and God. That does not matter what I go, look at fam. You are anointed to make money for the glory of God. Wait, let me finish my confession first. I won't say that joke, but you know what I'm thinking. All right. Money?
Money.
Look at it again.
Money.
Money. You multiply.
You multiply.
You increase.
You increase.
And you produce a maximum harvest for me.
Harvest?
I command you
to
come to me now
in Jesus' name.
Now who's the boss? I'm the boss. Now there's been a few times even we had to do this with our kids once in a while. I'm the boss. Now every once in a while I encourage this. If you're walking around in the mall, just so we know, I'm the boss. I'm the boss. So if I see a cute outfit, I'm going to first check with the Lord to see if this is the way that we go. I'm not kidding. If you got to do this stuff, I mean, I find myself even with loonies and toonies. You loony. You loon. Or whatever that, goon, what is that bird on it? It's a loon. All right. Who'd have thought that was a bird? All right. You loon. You toonie. You bear. You bear you. And Queen Elizabeth. You queen. You. I own you. Like, you have to talk to this stuff. Like, I'm so serious. We talk to golf balls all the time, and we wish they'd go in the hole. Not all the time. But I'm saying we got to look at this. Do you see this? Do you see this gentleman here? What is this? Sir Winfield, Laura, Prime Minister. He's a Prime Minister. You see, he's got ears on his head. He's got ears. He's listening to everything I say. Now, all I'm doing is if we can be, and like Luke 16, it says that if you can be faithful with money, let me just read it to you. This will make you throw your wallet at me. Okay, it says this. After verse 10, it says, if you are faithful in the little things, you will be found faithful in larger ones. But if you are dishonest in little things, you won't be honest with greater things. And if you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? Wow. Listen, we haven't even scratched the surface of the riches of heaven yet. And as a result, look at this. And so when he looks at this, trusted with light things, he puts light things with money. If we can be trusted with this little thing, guess what? You can have so much more. What do you want? What do you want? I'm not just talking stuff. What do you want? Where do you want your life to go? Where do you want your kids to go? What do you want to see happen in your jobs? What do you want to see happen in your company that you maybe own or you're working for? Who knows? You could be owning the thing. But if you are faithful in this little thing, I mean, look at this, $5, really? Yeah, if I'm faithful with this $5, he's able to entrust me with true riches of heaven. True riches. Woo, what's true riches? Man, that's an abundance. That's an abundance. The Bible already says that the windows of heaven have been opened upon us. So what do we do? Have we seen that yet? I'm not to be judging or condescending, but have we seen that yet? Not yet. What's wrong? Something's wrong then. And it's not with him. It's not like God's stingy. He's a giver. That's what he wants. He wants to show himself strong. in behalf of those whose hearts are fully committed, devoted to Him. And this is the biggest area where people are not doing the devotedness part, is the finances. If we're able to not give a rip about finances, guess what? The more that will be coming towards us. That's how it is. That's how it is. So I want you to look at this thing. Get your wallet out. Look at this thing. Just laugh. Go, money, I own you. I own every cent of you. You don't control my life. You don't control my decisions. I control you. And you're used to bring God glory. You're used to advance the church. You're used to move the church forward. That's what you're used for. So you listen to me. And you move the church forward in Jesus' name. Now as a result, I wish it was more. Sorry, fam. That's all. Then you just freely give it. And nothing doesn't hold you back. Right? Make sense? Amen. So Father, we worship you. We thank you so much for your goodness. We thank you that you love us, that you would share this with us. Lord, we take this as a knock on our door to our heart. And Lord, we open it. We freely open it this morning. And we thank you, Lord, that we make a decision to serve you, to stand with you, and to do everything that you've called us to do. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 Come on, sweetie.
So good. Amen. And you never know what's on the other side of your obedience, right? You never know. When God says so, you don't go, well, what, why? You never know what's on the other side of your obedience. Mm-hmm. We could say a lot more of that. But we just want to take care of a little family business. Some of you probably know that Pastor Sheila's mama went home to be with Jesus this week.
Yeah.
And Pastor Sheila has been dancing in her tears because she's like, we are going to be together so soon, and we're all going to be together with your mama. It's going to be a really good time. So just lift up the Glover family this week and give them some extra love, as we know that you will. And also, we just want to say, if you have, if you're going through something right now and you've got some needs and you want some people to agree with you in prayer, there's going to be a prayer team up here in a few minutes as you go. Just come on up and get some prayer, and we will see you all through the week.
Yeah. Have an awesome afternoon.